Welcome back. Today's presentation will be the remaining part of the origin of angiosperm flowers. In our earlier presentation, we discussed several topics like how did flowers evolve, what are those fossil records reveal about the evolution of flowers, and we have taken several fossil evidences like Ficus speciosissima, Archaeopteryx, Amberola species, etc. And also we discussed in detail about the molecular evidences. So what are the views of Takhtajan, what are the views of Robert Thorne, and Takhtajan, Cronquist, etc. regarding the origin of angiosperm flowers. And we also discussed about the characters of primitive and derived or advanced characters of a flower. So based on this flower, there were several hypotheses originated regarding the evolution of flowers. So basically two hypotheses we could discuss. One is the woody magnolide hypothesis and the second is the paleoherb hypothesis. So again, several factors responsible for derivation of angiosperm were also discussed in my earlier presentation, and several reports by molecular biologists who have thrown the light on the evolution or the origin of angiosperms. So in today's class, dear friends, we'll be discussing about the diversification of the angiosperm and the radiations in the angiosperm phylogeny and the convergent evolution and adaptive radiation of beetle pollinated angiosperm, and a bit regarding the pollination biology will be discussed, because in our earlier presentation I told that the angiosperms and the insects co-evolved. So in today's class we'll have a look upon what are those evidences which prove that the angiosperms and the insects and beetles co-evolved. So that also we'll be discussing, and role of pollination biology in understanding the angiosperm, and how whether plants and pollinators co-evolved. We'll have some of the evidences, and we'll have a discussion on that also. And plant pollen interactions, and also various modifications of the flower in order to suit the pollinators. So what were these modifications in the floral parts in order to suit the different pollinators? So what are those modifications in order to suit the water pollination, wind pollinated flower? How this bee pollinated flower will be modified? What will the color, shape, size of different parts of the flowers, and butterfly modified pollinated flowers, beetle pollinated flowers? Several things regarding the different pollinators will be discussed in this today's class, and of course it will be, I hope it will be one of the interesting discussion regarding the evolution or origin of angiosperms or the flowers, and different flower adaptations to lure insects. And so different principles of flower evolution will also be discussed, and different evolutionary modifications in the flowering floral parts like derived piperian features of stamina, how this stamina evolved, and different evolution of a carpel and evolution of epigyny. All these various aspects regarding the evolution of flower will be discussed in detail along with the beautiful photographs. Yes friends, let's get started. Although the best known for articulating the concept of evolution by natural selection, Charles Darwin explored a host of other topics, laying the foundation for subsequent scientific inquiry in fields as diverse as plant structure or function, carnivorous plants, and phylogenetics. And in fact, scientists in the last field openly acknowledged Darwin's major contribution from the sketch of evolutionary relationships in his notebook in 1837 to the single figure, that is on his book on the origin of species, clearly depicting extant species and the historical collections that preceded them, to his beautiful description of the great life tree of life. So this clear representation of phylogeny by the Darwin set the stage for rapid advances in understanding and visualizing the tree of life, for example, in the writings and illustrations of Haeckel and those who followed it. Far less well known than Darwin's explanation of evolution by natural selection or his concept of tree of life is his immense contribution to both basic and evolutionary botany. Indeed, Darwin was the original evolutionary botanist, having applied evolutionary principles to botanical questions, even as he wrote on the origin of species. Charles Darwin has published 6 books and over 75 papers on plants, with topics ranging from fossil records of angiosperms to reproductive biology, especially reproduction of orchids, insectivorous plants, plants domestication, and even plant movement. Darwin's botanical contributions both strengthened his evolutionary arguments by providing specific examples of principles presented in On the Origin of Species, and this laid the foundation for evolutionary botany. So our discussion starts with the contributions of Charles Bessy regarding the phylogeny or the origin of evolution of angiosperms. So Charles Bessy was an American botanist, and his arrangement of angiosperm taxa emphasizes the evolutionary divergence of primitive forms, is considered by many as a system most likely to form the basis of modern comprehensive taxonomy of the plant kingdom. So because of its emphasis on North American species, however, Bessy's taxonomy in its original form, representing more than 23 years of development, has found application only in the north central region of the United States. Anyways, Charles Bessy is a well-known botanist, his depiction of angiosperm relationship. So the popular tree, which is called as phylogeny tree, which is called as Bessy's cactus, is used by most of the phylogeneticists now. Armin Takhtajan is one of the advanced taxonomists who was the head of Department of Higher Plants at the Komarov Botanical Institute in Leningrad, Russia, presented a system of classification which was first published in the very preliminary form, that was published in 1942, and the actual system, however, appeared in 1959 in German in his book Die Evolution der Angiosperm. So Takhtajan's system of classification is basically of Bessy-Hallier tradition, which considered all evidences from different fields, including morphological, anatomical, embryological, cytological, palynological, paleobotanical, chemical, and ultrastructural evidences while classifying the angiosperms. Takhtajan considered angiosperms to be monophyletic in origin, and that they arose from some ancient group of gymnosperms. The monocotyledons are considered to have been derived from primitive dicots. And he divided the magnoliophyta, that is angiosperms, into two classes, magnoliopsida, dicots, and liliopsida, monocots, of which magnoliopsida is considered primitive and liliopsida have been derived from magnolias under magnoliopsida. Arthur Cronquist was an internationally renowned systematic botanist, was born on March 19, 1919. He was greatly influenced by his mentor, Professor Ray J. Davies. After he joined the University of Idaho, he obtained his BSA and degree from Utah University, and where he also worked on the Aster foliaceous complex under the direction of Dr. Bassett Magri. So Cronquist has written the book Natural Geography of Plants with Henry Gleason. He conducted several extensive surveys throughout North America and studied and collected the plants of intermountain regions of the western United States. During his association, he also became proficient in Russian and visited the Soviet Union on several occasions and promoted scientific exchanges between the two countries. And Arthur Cronquist presented the system of classification for dicots in 1957, which was later modified and published in collaboration with two other eminent botanists in 1966. However, the final modification appeared in 1988. Cronquist, in his book Evolution and Classification of Flowering Plants, is largely based on literature, personal observations, and discussions with other botanists. This system of classification is an elaboration of Bess's system of classification and refinement over Takhtajan's system. Magnoliopsida and Liliopsida, which have been further divided into subclasses, orders and families, and he classified that there are total 382 families under the angiosperms, of which 317 are under Magnoliopsida, that is dicots, and 65 under Liliopsida. Rolf Dahlgren. So, Dahlgren's system of classification is majorly based on the characters drawn from several branches of botany, including anatomy, embryology, and chemistry. So, Dahlgren believed that none of the extant groups of flowering plants is ancestral to any present-day group. And he was of the view that the angiosperms are of monophyletic origin and have evolved from one particular line of gymnosperms. So, among dicots, Magnoliophlorae was considered most primitive, and among monocots, Alismatiflorae has been regarded as most primitive, according to Dahlgren. And Dahlgren was more phylogenetic in this thinking, point to a close relationship among the families that produce mustard oil glucosides, that is called Dahlgrenograms. Highly it was influential to all other phylogeneticists. Another phylogenetist, Robert Thorne. Robert Thorne proposed a pure phylogenetic system of classification on the basis of characters of comparative morphology, cytology, embryology, paleobotany, plant geography, pollen and seed morphology. He also included in his discussion ultrastructure and host parasite relationships, and he believed in the monophyletic origin of angiosperms. Robert Thorne treats the flowering plants at the rank of class with an initial bifurcation into two subclasses. Related orders are placed within each subclass as superorders, and within these, clusters of related families are grouped into suborders. So, he divided the class Angiospermae into two subclasses. One is Dicotyledonae and Monocotyledonae, which were further subdivided into 28 superorders, 54 orders, 73 suborders, 350 families, 12,255 genera, and 225,490 species. So, as I told, there are about more than 3 lakhs flowering plants living on the earth. So, this is with a lot of diversity in different color, shape, size, aroma, fragrance. So, there are various number of diversities seen in angiosperm flowers. So, there is a radiation seen in angiosperm phylogeny. The recurrent pattern in angiosperm phylogeny is radiation, as indicated by clustering of short branches in a phylogenetic tree, and in many cases, the result of an increased rate of diversification is seen. So, that is what referred here as a radiation. And this angiosperm radiation is one of the evolutionary events that most puzzled Charles Darwin. In fact, he famously referred it as an abominable mystery. the seemingly sudden appearance of so many angiosperm species in the upper Cretaceous conflicted strongly with this gradualist perspective on evolutionary change. And obviously, since Charles Darwin, many new fossils have been found, and recently molecular data have given new opportunities to unravel evolutionary patterns. And now we know that the major groups including the Claranthaceae and Magnoliths, Eudaicots and Monocots already originated in the early Cretaceous, that is 125 million years ago, but there is no convincing evidence of angiosperms from pre-Cretaceous period. And the emerging picture is that after divergence of the major angiosperm lines by the late Barremian, that is 125 million years ago, there was a steady but impressive increase in diversity of angiosperms. As you can see here in this graph, this here different colors, pink, blue, green, various colors are given, dark green and light green. So this pink color represents the presence of angiosperms. This means that angiosperms were present from Paleocene era to mid Meiochromian era, about 150 million years ago. And before that, cycads were present, ferns, conifers, gingkophytes and other gymnosperms were said to be present as per the graphs. And this also depicts that angiosperms evolved around till 600 million years ago, that there was the evidence of presence of angiosperms. And nowadays, most of the authors assume that during the first million years of angiosperms remained relatively rare until eventually an impressive rise to ecological dominance took place. That is, in Albian era, 5 million years, the percentage of angiosperms in the local paleofloras was still only 5 to 20%, but this percentage had increased to 80 to 100% in the Maastrichtian at the end of the Cretaceous, that is 65 million years ago. So analyzed in fact, angiosperm evolution is punctuated repeatedly by radiations ranging in time from near the origin of the angiosperms to recent events associated with the colonization of new habitats such as volcanic islands and recently glaciated areas in both Arctic and Alpine areas. Another line of work which has tried to illuminate the ecology of early angiosperms says that it has produced several hypotheses, including the idea that the early angiosperms were, they say that early angiosperms were weedy shrubs that lived in open, disturbed habitats of semi-arid tropical to subtropical regions. And they say that plants of disturbed streamside habitats were seen in mesic environments. And fast-growing semi-herbaceous plants of sunny, unstable stream sites that tolerated disturbance and had high leaf photosynthetic capacity and shortened generation times were seen, and woody plants that grew in the dimly lit disturbed forest understory habitats and shady streamside settings were also seen, were also reported, and fragile herbaceous plants growing in aquatic of marsh habitats were also reported, and there were also some plants with xeromorphic features suggesting that grew in dry environments. And early angiosperms were apparently most frequently found in the sites that were assumed to be disturbed, and early angiosperms there were mostly present in disturbed sites or even aquatic or extremely dry conditions. The only overlapping aspect of these views is that early angiosperms were assumed to grow in sites without ferns or tall gymnosperm trees. In the absence of ferns and tall gymnosperm trees, early angiosperm evolved. This was the only overlapping aspect. So, in most of the phylogenesis view, they suggest that they had difficulties competing with these groups of plant species. angiosperms had difficulty of competing with the ferns or tall gymnosperms. Yet at the end of Cretaceous, that is 65 million years, angiosperms had become major contributors to biomass, not only in disturbed or aquatic habitats, but also in stable terrestrial environments where competition was with the gymnosperms and ferns must have played a significant role. So this is opinion of Hickey and Doyle, which was published in 1977. This is a photograph showing the ordinal level phylogeny of angiosperm based on the APG4. Branch color shows species richness, that is different colors starting from red, pink, light pink, violet, purple, dark blue, light blue, etc. So based on the angiosperm phylogeny, so yellow starbursts refers to major radiations, and around the border are typical representative species. These are typical representative species, and this color represent, pink color represent high species of richness. So nothing to bother about this, just to make you understand that this is what called the radiation of angiosperm, angiosperm evolution. Yeah, there are several evidences which prove the co-evolution of the plants with animals, that is particularly with the insects, beetles. Through the ages, flowers evolved by developing symbiotic relationships with animal world. Initially, all the flowers were radially symmetrical and were pollinated by beetles. And these beetles have evolved long before honeybees. And magnolias are known to date back some 110 million years to the Cretaceous period. It is only the tertiary during the late Paleocene and the early Eocene, that is 52 to 63.6 million years ago, the first evidence of bilaterally symmetrical flowers was found, which is an adaptation of specialized pollinators such as bees and some birds. During the early tertiary, the bilateral organization of floral organs co-evolved with animal behavior independently at different times and in various groups of angiosperms. And this convergent evolution and the adaptive radiation of beetle pollinated angiosperms prove that although a majority of beetle pollinated species are represented by magnolids and basal monocots, that means most of the magnolids and the basal monocots are pollinated by the beetles, and beetle pollinated systems have evolved independently in 14 families of eudicots and 6 families of petaloid monocots. So approximately 184 angiosperm species are pollinated almost exclusively by beetles. However, the high proportion of beetle pollinated systems within magnolide relics supports the view that modern insect pollinated flowers were derived largely from beetle pollinated proto-angiosperms. So this means that beetles and angiosperms have co-evolved, because magnolids, according to some of the taxonomists, they say that magnolias are some of primitive angiosperms, and most of the magnolids and basal monocots are pollinated by beetle, and approximately in about 184 angiosperm species are pollinated almost exclusively by beetles. Yes, role of pollination biology plays a major role in understanding angiosperm diversification. Pollination biology describes the association between the floral traits and pollinator behavior. For floral traits like different parts of a flower, it may be modification of a stigma, or it may be adaptation of the petals, anthers, and different many other floral parts which get adopted to the pollinator behavior. So pollination biology is an association between the floral traits and pollinator behavior, and also the mechanical fit between the pollinator and the pollen bearing and pollen receiving structures, and it also deals with the importance of biotic and abiotic interactions at the species to community levels. And today, of course, the role of pollinator differences in driving speciation and diversification is well recognized. Yeah, did this plants and pollinators co-evolve? Let us have a look into it. What several studies about this co-evolution of plants and pollinators say about. The co-evolution of flowering plants and their animal pollinators presents one of the nature's most striking examples of adaptation and speciation. And also, animal flowering plant interaction is a classic example of co-evolution. So, its co-evolution also demonstrates how the interaction between the two groups of organisms can be a font of biological diversity. Flowering plants are adapting to their pollinators, which are in turn adapting to the plants. Each of the participating organisms thus presents an evolutionary moving agent. That is, the relationship between these distantly related taxa is a symbiotic in the broad sense that characterizes life and that gives rise to high degree of complexity and diversity that we perceive in the nature. For example, bees appear to be especially adept to perceiving bilateral symmetry and the colors blue and yellow and at manipulating flower parts. So, bees are attracted to the yellow and blue colors. So, plants being pollinated by bees are subjected to a strong selective pressure favoring bilateral symmetry and those colors. And in turn, the flowers exert pressure on the bees favoring hairiness, body shape and behavior that effectively transfer pollen. The resulting specialization can favor a trend toward an exclusive relationship, which may be to the benefit of each participant. And in turn, the plant gains the constancy of the bee, which majors on the particular species and facilitates pollination of widely spaced specialized flower. Flowers evolve elaborate methods to attract animal pollinators, and animals evolve specialized body parts and the behaviors of the that aid the plant pollination. So this acts as a primary driver or a selective force for the evolution of tremendous diversity of flowering plants on Earth. Yeah, flowers and pollinators engage in evolutionary race. Flower spur becomes slightly deeper, pollinators evolve longer tongues. As deeper the spur, the longer the tongues of the insects or the animals. So Darwin in 1862 predicted that a jungle orchid with a long deep flower would be pollinated by a moth with an equally 1 foot long tongue. So, a long spur. So, co-evolution can be a complex involving the interaction of numerous characteristics, or in some cases, it can be simpler, such as when the back and forth pressure favoring longer floral tubes and longer insect tongues or bird beaks can lead to extremes of each. Example, hummingbird. Hummingbird beaks and the longer tubular flowers in some of the plants they pollinate are often used as an example. The plants with the long tubular flowers and the beak of the hummingbird, they pollinate. These two are the examples used in co-evolution, used as an example to understand co-evolution of animals and plants. Here we need to remember the example given by Charles Darwin, where he described an interesting case of pollinator flowering plant co-evolution in Madagascar. The star orchid, Angraecum sexvipedale. So this is an orchid. This has foot long spurs with nectary at the tip. The long spur is very much it is in foots. It has at its tip nectars. So in 1862, when Darwin examined this orchid, he predicted that a long-tongued moth would be found that pollinated it. No moth with that extreme length of the tongue was known at that time, but it is now well known in the present time. Then in 1903, he was proven correct when the long-tongued moth Xanthopan morganiae predicta was discovered. So it was so named because its occurrence had been predicted. So such an insect which was discovered by Darwin had a 12-inch tongue, and insect pollinators therefore are directly involved in the evolutionary direction of the flowering plants. Aconitum and Aquilegius also seem to have specifically co-evolved in the long-tongued bumblebees. So this is a photograph showing the hawk moth, that is Xanthopan morgani predicta. You can see it has such a long tongue. So it's mentioned that it has a almost 12-inch long tongue. So this is an orchid. So where you can see it is trying to take the nectar from the flower. So Xanthopan morgani predicta. So this is commonly the hawk moth, which was discovered in 1903. Although Darwin predicted the existence of such an moth in 1862 itself. So it has the hawk moth Xanthopan morgani predicta uses its long specially adapted proboscis to pollinate the Madagascar star orchid and Angraecum sexvipedale. A recent report on the origin of flowering plants and the pollinators by Caspar Cool and Jeff Allerton in the journal Science published on June 19, 2020. So this is that for more than a century there has been a fascination with a surprisingly rapid rise and early diversity of flowering plants. So Darwin also described the seemingly explosive diversification of angiosperms as an abominable mystery, and debates continue about the origin and processes driving angiosperm speciation. Dating the origin of angiosperms was traditionally the prerogative of paleobotanists who read the fossil record of plants, but with the DNA sequencing becoming increasingly sophisticated, molecular dating methods have come to the table. Many angiosperm fossils can be dated dated back to the early Cretaceous, which has led paleobotanists to reason that they originated during that era. It is now increasingly recognized that angiosperms are probably older than the oldest fossil. But how much older remains controversial? That is a question. So when angiosperms originated is a key to understanding the origin and evolution of pollinators, particularly insects such as bees, butterflies, moths and flies. So plant pollinator interactions are one of the important concepts to understand about the origin of flowers. There are two types of pollinations. One is highly specialized pollination and another is generalized pollination. So in highly specialized pollination, only one animal species pollinates only one flowering plant species. Example, yucca plant is pollinated by only yucca moth only, and yucca moth pollinates only yucca plant. So this is called specialized interaction. So in generalized pollination, multiple animals pollinate a given plant species, or when a certain pollinator visits many different species of the plants. most of the flowers have their own ways of attracting pollinators from a distance. Their shapes, colors and fragrances bring the pollinator to the flower from a far distance. So in this photograph you can see the orchid Ophrys speculum. So this exactly mimics the female species of a bee. So sexual deception, where the flower attracts male pollinators by mimicking a female of the same species. So that is the scent, color and hair of the female species looks alike the orchid, but it is actually orchid, not a bee. So typically pollination by sexual deception is highly specific, and usually only one involves one insect species. There are about 25,000 species of orchids reported, of which only one-third of which are pollinated by deceit, giving no reward. Only 400 are sexually deceptive. And again, different butterflies, flies and bees are attracted by sweet fragrant flowers. And yellow flowers attract bees, and various shapes of many orchids actually mimic those of insects and fool them into mating with the flower. So, did the evolution of floral parts meant to suit the pollinators? Let us have a look what different concepts say about this point. So, was evolution of floral parts meant to suit pollinators? The same is true to the pistils. Yes, modification in the pistils in order to suit the pollinators is an evidence to prove that insects or the animals or the pollinators co-evolve with the plants. Pistils that extend beyond the stamens reveal pollination by insects. A pollinator delivers pollens from the another flower on the way in and picks up the new pollen on the way out. And extended pistils in flowers also decreases the chances of pollen falling onto the pistil of the same flower. That is, it avoids self-pollination. Angiosperm flowers have evolved to achieve effective pollination. A position of different floral parts tends to maximize the delivery of pollen to the right pollinator. And again, stamens extending far away from the flower can be indication that wind is pollen vector. And stamens that lay close to the flower, that is stamens which are inserted into the flower, indicate a pollen vector that must land and walk inside like a fly. So this means the stamens which are exerted in the flower, they indicate that the wind is a pollen vector, and stamens which are inserted indicate a pollen vector that must, they should first land and walk inside like a fly does. Yeah, when we talk about the co-evolution about with the plants and insects, that is particularly bees, which evolved first, the bee or the flowering plant? Till recent, it was believed that flowering plants emerged much earlier than the pollinators. But recent discovery of 100 million year old bee embedded in amber in Myanmar suggests that early bees and the flowering plants may have been contemporaries, and bees may have driven the diversification of early flowering plants. Primitive angiosperms may have taken advantage of bee behavior by developing various colors and scents for their flowers as a pollination strategy to compete with the gymnosperms. Again, there is a view that insects probably evolved as early as Silurian. Silurian period is between 410 to 435 million years. The Silurian, the insects had no role in pollination, and there were no flowering plants during that Silurian period. And during the late Carboniferous, that is 295 to 355 million years ago, there evolved fern-like plants that were mostly wind-pollinated. Only in Triassic, that is 203 to 250 million years ago, there is evidence of insects such as beetles and flies visiting these wind-pollinated plants. And again, during Cretaceous period, there is a first evidence of nectaries in flowers, possibly signaling the arrival of symbiotic relationship between the angiosperms and their pollinating insects. Gradually, flowers started reacting and adapting to what the bees were looking for, and the mouth parts of the insects also started reacting to suit to the harvest of the rewards better. So, evolution of diversity of different flower shapes to suit different kinds of pollinators. So as per the evidences and as per the in the pictures, you can see that the flower type, shape, color, odor, nectar and structure vary by the type of a pollinator that visits them. Such characteristics are considered pollination syndromes. In open bowl shaped flask. This open bowl shaped flask in the first photograph you can see here. These are the two open bowl shaped flasks, Potentillas and Ranunculus. So these have a ring of copious pollen in the center of the flower. Here in the center of the flower there will be a ring of copious pollens. Example in poppies, Potentilla, Ranuncula species, there will be a ring of copious pollen at the center of the flower. So they are open access. They are not covered with any petals. These are openly accessed by the pollinators. So they are open access flowers used by honeybees, bumblebees and certain solitary bees. So bumblebees sometimes also vibrate their wings in such flowers to dislodge pollen. And in flat open flowers like geraniums, so they do offer nectar, usually secreted in the nectar is located between the petals to attract the bees. And in some flowers like brush shaped flowers, mostly Asteraceae families and some of the Thalictrums without petals, brush shaped flowers without petals such as those of willows and some members of Asteraceae and some number of Caryophyllaceae and those of Thalictrums also. These are mainly wind pollinated but in some cases are also a source of pollen for bumblebees. So these are different types of diversity of flower shapes to suit different kinds of pollinators. And the Cruciferian Caryophyllaceae members, these have round flowers with a tubular center. So these are long tube-like flowers which with a tubular center, Cruciferae and Caryophyllaceae members. These appeal mainly to moths and butterflies. So moths and butterflies, they push their long thin tongue in the center of the flower to drink the nectar. Again, the members of Lamiaceae or Fabaceae, these have specialized flowers. Those are bilipped flowers, petals. So they have close relationship with the bumblebees or a solitary bees. The lip forms the landing platform. The bee then pushes its head into the flower to get nectar. At the same time, the plant places pollen on the back of the bee and this bee carries pollen from flower to flower for pollination. In the flowers with the umbels inflorescence, umbelliferous, there will be flowers, small flat open flowers in bunches. So these present nectar openly and shallowly and appeal to hoverflies, small beetles and small solitary bees. Asteraceae members are compound flower heads made up of hundreds of tiny flowers or florets. All are tightly packed together. These also appeal for the bees. Yeah, there are different modifications of the flowers for different pollinators. That is, for water pollination, there are different modifications of the flower. For wind pollination, that is anemophily, there are different modifications of a flower. And for bee pollination also, there are different modifications. And for the butters to pollinate, the flowers have different modifications. And still many more flower modifications are seen for different pollinators. For example, water pollination. So this water pollination is conspicuously specialized in the submerged Ceratophyllaceae and Cabombaceae members. So water plant Brassinia, but belonging to the family Cabombaceae, has an increased stigma surface. So due to this increased stigma surface, the water pollination is being easily seen. And in the flowers which are pollinated by the wind, that is called anemophily, pollination by wind. The wind pollinated flowers, these are very small with no fragrance. They produce great quantities of pollen, more number of pollens are there. And normally plants with wind pollinated flowers grow close together. They grow close together compactly to allow for the wind to carry the pollen. Example of the wind pollinated flowers are grasses, Poaceae members, oak trees, willow trees and walnut trees. So these are the examples of wind pollinated which show the wind pollination. And abiotic pollination is uncommon in basal angiosperms. In bee pollinated flowers, that is melittophylli, the flowers are usually blue, yellow or purple with the fragrance, tight tubular or have long petals on the bottom of the bees, on the bottom for the bees to land, and usually they have the markings on the petals called honey guides that guide the bee to the nectar. And in psychophily, that is butterfly pollination, here the flowers are usually red or orange with the fragrance, normally flat topped or in capitulum, long tubular to accommodate the insertion of long proboscis deep into the flower of a sucking nectar. In bee pollinated flowers, that is called cantharophylli, the flowers are usually dull color or white with strong fragrance or odor. The bowl shaped or in flat topped clusters, ovary inferior, to help the beetle to chew flower parts and eat pollen. And in meiophylli, that is the pollination by fly, the flowers are dark colored with strong odor, broad, that is open, or in flat topped clusters, example Saprea, Rafflesia, Aristolochia, etc. In ornithogamy, that is pollination by hummingbird, the flowers are red or yellow with little or no fragrance, the tube shaped with lots of watery nectar rich in carbohydrates attracts the hummingbirds. In chiropterogamy, that is pollination by bats, the flowers will be dull colored and large with the fruity or fetid fragrance. Flower has a white corolla with lots of nectars. The bat has a long tongue and a long thin muzzle to reach to the corolla. That is to example in Parkia species, the flowers are dull color and with a large fruity or fetid fragrance is seen, and the flower in Parkia has a white corolla with lots of nectars. Approximately 67 families and about 528 species of angiosperms are pollinated by nectar feeding bats. There are several flower adaptations to lure insects. A large group and a successful Asteraceae members, they have many flowers arranged to draw attention to the of the insects to the display. The flowers typically have a delicate sweet scent which bees can smell. Usually the nectar is at the end of some type of small narrow floral tube which is right length to fit the tongue of the particular species. So here you can see the bees are pollinating the Asteraceae members. So nectar, usually the nectar is at the end of some type of small narrow floral tube which is right length to fit the tongue of the particular species of the bee that pollinates that plant. And bee pollinated flowers typically have a sturdy zygomorphic corolla with landing platform, where most of the Asteraceae flowers are zygomorphic. Yeah, in order to make the pollination or successful or attract the butterflies, that is pollination by butterfly is called psychophylli, there are several modifications seen. So the butterfly pollinated flower is usually red or orange. The flower may be tube shaped as the butterfly has long tongue to insert deep into the tubular flower. This is a long tongue of the butterfly, and the flower may be flat topped as butterfly likes open places where it can sit over the fly and draw the nectar, and the flower may be capitulum or other inflorescence as the butterfly usually sits on many flowers at one stop. And we should remember that butterflies are diurnal and have good vision but weak sense of smell. So in this photograph, the hummingbird pollinated flowers are mostly red, tube shaped, with lots of water and nectar rich in carbohydrates. And hummingbird, in order to draw the nectars, it must hover and reach deep inside the flower to reach the reward. The anthers dust the bird so that its pollen end up on another species of the same kind. And these flowers, Erythrina crystagalli, that is a crybaby tree, the flowers usually do not have a strong odor because the hummingbirds do not have a particularly well developed sense of smell. So for the hummingbird pollinated flowers, the flowers will be mostly red color, tube shaped, with less aroma and lot of nectaries. In fly pollinated flower, that is Myophyllae, the fly pollinated flowers will be dark or brownish red in color with strong odor. So for example, this Cypraea himalayana, exerts the strong fetid smell even from a meter distance. Any person can smell. If such smell is seen, it seems that the Cypraea himalayana is in flowering now. So the strong odor typically have a strong bad or rotten sort of fetid smell, as you can see in Cypraea himalayana and several Cypraea species. They grow in open or a flat topped cluster, as most flies have short tongues. So since most of the flies have short tongues, so the top of the flower will be flat topped in, usually in clusters. This is Aristolochus, remember, this is Cypraea himalayana. Yeah, in moth pollinated flowers, most of the moths are nocturnal and they have good sense of smell. And moth pollinated flowers mostly are white in color or pale color, so that they are visible on a moonlit night. They use strong sweet perfume to advertise their presence in the darkness, and this odor is only exuded at the night. This odor is only exuded due to the in the night and not during the daytime, and hence the moths visit the flower during the night time. So moths are hover feeders. So these flowers have deep tubes to precisely match the length of a specific moth's tongue. Yeah, in bee pollinated flowers, there is wide diversity seen. Bat pollinated flowers of the inflorescence can be of three categories based on their shape. One is shaving brush type. Second is stamen ball with many projecting stamens, example Bombax, Caparis, Eugenia and Musa species. And third type is a cup shaped with an open corolla, example Ceiba. So this bat pollinated flowers are long, bristly tongues to lap up nectar and pollen. Flowers open at night, white or light colored, visible in moonlight. Bat pollinated flowers have a musty, fetid odor, like the smell of bats. They exactly match like the smell of bats, and these flowers are large and sturdy to withstand insertion of bat's head as it licks nectar and the pollen. Example in cactus. Bats are nocturnal with a good sense of smell. Coming to the principles of flower evolution, the evolutionary process in flowers is guided fundamentally by two basic principles that are subserved by three tendencies, which is mentioned in the book Economy Principle in Plants. This was proposed as early as 1913 by H.F. Wernham. Two principles are principle of productive parts. Second is principle of progressive adaptation to the insect visitors. There are basically two principles. Principle of progressive economy in the production of reproductive parts. Second principle is principle of progressive adaptation to the insect visitors. The first principle refers to reduction in the number of not only floral parts but also in the overall size of the flower, as we can see in the reduction in the floral parts and size of the flowers in asteraceae members of Compositae. The lesser the number of the floral parts, the more advanced it is. Hence, high reduction in size and number of the parts simply means that a decreased chance of pollination, which is against the norms of natural selection. And the second principle, the principle of progressive adaptation, therefore comes to subserve the first principle by three tendencies. So this second principle subserves the first principle by it has three tendencies. What are those three tendencies? Let us see, have a look. Three subserved tendencies for principles of evolution, flower evolution, are: tendency to increased conspicuousness of flowers; second, tendency towards flower modification in relation to visiting insects; third, tendency towards fusion of floral parts. So let us study one by one these three subserved tendencies, which for the principles of flower of evolution. First tendency, tendency to increased conspicuousness of flowers. So by enlargement of an individual flower or by aggregation of the flowers into dense inflorescence, the flower has a tendency to enlarge the individual flower or the aggregation of the flowers into dense inflorescence. So this increased conspicuousness of flowers is reflected in the petaloid perianth, perhaps from Cycadioidae to early magnoliales. So in early magnoliales, increased conspicuousness of flowers is achieved by a huge cost of energy with indefiniteness of all floral parts. In magnoliales, more flowers are very conspicuous. They are large with scented and bright colored floral parts. So pollination in such magnoliales or the such flowers, conspicuous flowers, is certainly effective, but again only one flower will be present. Petaloid perianth gradually led to the heterochlamydous flowers, that is outer productive green calyx and inner attractive corolla. Second tendency towards flower modification in relation to visiting insects. So this tendency is to subserve second fundamental principles of progressive adaptation to visiting insects. This is achieved by the modification of regular actinomorphic flowers into irregular zygomorphic flowers. So zygomorphy is less developed in primitive polypetalae, whereas well developed in sympetalae, perhaps because of functional constraints. Zygomorphy in angiosperm flowers goes hand in hand with insect pollination. Zygomorphy coupled with aggregation of flowers into inflorescence is another advancement for the visiting insects. Both the principle of economy and principle of progressive adaptation to visiting insects is best achieved in families like Asteraceae. Tendency is tendency towards fusion of floral parts. So this tendency subserves both the fundamental principles of floral evolution and relates to the fusion of floral parts. Fusion of floral parts serves the economy on space and material, that is fusion of carpels with receptacle, as in the case of Rosaceae, Saxifragaceae, Rosaceae, Conariaceae, Podostomaceae, etc. So it also helps the pollinators for successful pollination. Material economy is also achieved by the development of short filaments or subsessile anthers, as in several epipetalous flowers belonging to the families Pramilaceae, Myrsiniaceae, Plumaginaceae, etc. And also the development of short filaments also helps in accommodating specific pollinators. The fused petals are connected with the principle of adaptation to insect visitor, and the tubular corolla helps in concealment of the nectar, and fused stamens, that is to form the staminal tube, is another adaptation to insect visits. And the example of this members of Fabaceae, Geraniaceae, and families of Malvaceae, these have fused stamens. And Gynastegium, development of the Gynastegium in highly specialized flowers of Asclepiaceae is a similar adaptation in order to attract the insects. And throughout polypetaly at various level attempts, Levels attempts towards the development of Sympetalous corolla thus indicates the polyphyletic origin of the sympetalae. So several evolutionary modifications in the floral parts have evolved in attraction for the pollinators. Primitive flowers lack differentiation of calyx corolla. They exhibit no economy in the production of indefinite number of floral parts, have no specialization for insect visitors, no aggregation, no chlorosis, no zygomorphy or no fusion of parts renders less attraction towards the insect visitors. Gradual transition between outer green leaf parts and inner colored whorls is noticed even in primitive angiosperms like magnolials, iliciales and peonials, indicating petals are later acquisition originating from the bracts. Other primitive taxa like nymphaeales, ranunculales, papaverales and caryophyllales show a transition between outer petal-like structures and inner fertile stamens indicate their staminal growth. And again, petals in flowering plants are therefore in of dual origin. So, modifications or evolutionary derivation of perianth features. So, they include evolution of two distinct whorls of perianth, that is calyx and corolla, and there were regular number of floral parts and fusion of sepals and petals and zygomorphy and development of spurs, tubes, etc. These were the derived perianth features. And all these above derived features are resultant of selective pressure towards specialized pollination mechanisms, and each of these trends has occurred independently and repeatedly in different evolutionary lines. So as reports by Stebbins 1974, he showed that showed 10 separate lines of zygomorphy. So along with the evolutionary modifications of the angiosperm flowers, there were different flower types evolved. Initially, there were flowers with numerous free perianth lobes, followed by pentamerous free perianth lobes, then evolved zygomorphic corolla with free petals, and sympetalous arcuate corolla flowers were seen, and infundibulum form corolla type, salvaform corolla type, and bilabiate, and finally, advanced characters, that is tuberal corolla type, were seen along with the evolution of the. These are the different types of arrangement of stamens, that is fascicular type of stamens, epipetalous type of stamens, that is petals were arranged were present on the ovate petals, stamens were present on the petals, diadelphous stamens, monodelphous stamens and syngenaceous type of stamens, and there were different gynoecial types, apocarpous, semicarpous and syncarpous. In order to understand the evolution of a flower, evolution of a stamina plays a major role in giving a clear concept of evolution of a flower. So usually stamen consists of a delimited anther which is composed of two longitudinally dehiscing thecae to which is attached a uninode filament. In angiosperms, the most primitive type of stamen is broad laminar three-node structure on one side of which are bound two thecae as in the case of degeneraceae. Such laminar stamen has gradually transformed as appendicular to petaloid to stamen, supporting structure into a distinct filament. And other derived features in stamen evolution are a development of specialized valvular or pericetal dehiscence and of various stamen fusion such as monodelphy, diadelphy and epipetally. The evolution of stamen size, number and adhesion are related to the function of effective discharge of a pollen. The elongation of filaments is another derived features in wind pollinated flowers, mainly to rise to the anthers above the floral parts. And adhesion of stamens facilitates effective pollination in insect pollinated flowers, that is anthers come in contact with the body of the insects. And again, the reduction in number of the stamens is also a general trend that we see in most of the sympetalous flowers. So these photographs show you different stamen structures. This is appendicular type of stamens. This is laminar type of stamen, petaloid stamen, typical volvular dehiscence stamen. These are different types of dehiscence. This is volvular dehiscence and this thing is poricidal dehiscence. The evolutionary story about the carpel of a flower in order to support the origin of flowers gradually. So carpel is a unit of gynecium consisting of a modified conduplicate megasporophyll with fused margins enclosing the ovules. Primitive carpels are unsealed conduplicate stipitate structure containing numerous ovules as in degeneri. Again, carpel ovulation is one of the important factor for the success of angiosperms. The ontogeny of a typical carpel shows a gradual transition from a laminar structure by fusion of margins and apical extension growth forming the style and the stigma. Evolution of epigyny or the inferior ovary from the superior ovary is a final derived feature of carpel evolution. The final derived feature of carpel evolution is evolution of inferior ovary from the superior ovary. So this is a diagrammatic representation of a derivation of a simple carpel from a conduplicate unsealed carpel type of a degeneri. Epigyny, epigynous ovary. Evolution of epigyny also plays an important role in understanding the evolution, evolutionary modification of different floral types or evolution of angiosperm flower. Inferior ovary. It is derived by the fusion of superior ovary with calyx, corolla and androecium. Here the calyx, corolla and androecium are fused. This gives result in inferior ovary. Inferior ovary is derived by the fusion of superior ovary. Fusion of superior ovary with calyx, corolla and androecium gives rise to inferior ovary. The free sepals, petals, stamens and gynecium inserted separately on the receptacle has given rise to the hypanthium or a calyx tube. By the adhesion of sepals to which petals, bases and filaments are fused to give rise to perigynous condition. So these conditions are seen in Rosaceae, Saxifragaceae and some of the leguminous flowers. Further trend in the same direction brings about the adhesion of hypanthium with the gynecium leading to epigynous condition, that is inferior ovary. Inferior ovary position is favored in flowers pollinated by animals with the potentially destructive mouthparts such as beetles or birds. The different floral characters in like Archiclamidae versus Sympetalae. Archiclamidae are the primitive ones and Sympetalae are the advanced characters of the flowers. So flowers of barely 20% of the species of Archiclamidae have stamens equal or less than the corolla lobes, whereas 96% of the Sympetalae are characterized by flowers of isomerous or oligomerous androecium. Again, 80% of the Archiclamidae have pistil composed of two syncapous carpels, whereas in Sympetalae more than 75% of the species have flowers with the bicarpate gynoecium. The progressive adaptation to insect visits is more active in Sympetalae, and zygomorphy occurs in 51% of the Sympetalae against barely 15% of the Archiclamidae. In Sympetalae, fusion of petals forming a tube goes hand in hand with oligomery on one side and progressive adaptation to insect visitors on the other hand. The term Archiclamidae here means polypetalae and monoclamidae of BNH, Bentham and Hooker. From my previous presentation regarding the origin of angiosperm flask, we could understand that both paleontological records and molecular analysis have their strengths and weaknesses. The strength of the fossils is that they can provide information on past form, function and clade richness, and indirectly provide information on speciation and extinction. So fossils are particularly useful when they harbor intermediate structures or combinations of characters that are no longer exist. So which can provide insightful examples that help to reconstruct the course of the evolutionary events. However, the interpretation of fossils can be subjective and controversial because important features of these plants may not be perceived, preserved, and often must be inferred from two-dimensional compressed remains. And the molecular analysis are built on hard to estimate variables such as the distribution of mutation rates across taxa and time. Variation in divergent times, which inevitably occurs in data sets with many species, frequently leads to overestimation of the age. Indeed, molecular analysis often push origin dates back in time, including the older lineages, but whether this is a methodological error remains unclear. Origin of angiosperm flower has been abominable history ever since Charles Darwin. Even the diversification of angiosperms remains so to modern evolutionists. Through the ages, flowers have co-evolved by developing symbiotic relationships with the animal world. Flowers have evolved by developing pollinator-specific flower morphologies to match the mouthparts of pollinating birds and insects. And early angiosperms might have taken advantage of bee behavior by developing various colors and scents of the flowers as pollination strategy to compete with then dominant gymnosperms and pro-angiosperms. This has led to enormous diversity of color, shapes, sizes, and aggregation in angiosperm flowers. Angiosperm reveal a trend from primitive beetle and fly pollinated flowers towards more advanced pollination by butterflies, moths, and bees. The entire flower evolution is guided fundamentally by two principles. One, principle of progressive economy in the production of reproductive parts, and second, principle of progressive adaptation to the insect visitors. Perhaps these two principles have worked in the entire episode of flower evolution, as can be assessed from primitive to derived groups of angiosperm. Therefore, it can be concluded that pollinating insects have a major role in driving the evolution and diversification of flowering plants. And the conclusions of Casper van der Kool and Jeff Allerton are also important to mention here, that they say that future paleontological discoveries will undoubtedly reveal additional fossils, and the use of complementary sequencing approaches and more sophisticated evolutionary models will help to mitigate the limitations imposed by the rampant polyploidy in plants that frequently hinders analysis of nuclear genes. Whether Darwin's question about the timing of flowering plant evolution and radiation will ever be answered remains a mystery, but clearly this question and its ecological implications for understanding the insect pollination are complicated. For more details, just you can go through their research publication published in Science recently on June 19th, 2020, by the title The Origins of Flowering Plants and Pollinators, authored by Casper J. van der Kool and Jeff Allerton. So with this conclusion, let me take a leave of you. I hope to see you in the next video lesson. I have tried to make the concept easy to understand by the students and the teachers and by the general audience who are keen to understand about the evolution of angiosperm flowers. Dear friends, please don't forget to subscribe. If you like this video, just like and comment. I'm just curiously waiting for your comments. Thank you so much for your kind patience and listening. See you in the next video lesson. Bye.